Let's have our next speaker get ready, start sharing a screen, and I'll give the introduction.
Yes. Can you see my screen?
Yep. All right. Nice. So our final speaker before the last show and tell session is Thomas Grun from Leipzig, Germany. And he uses the name Mr. Reason for releasing some of his music where he plays guitar. And he uses this new, pretty popular GitHub repository called Tidal Looper that allows you to do live sampling while you're coding in Tidal Cycles. So you can bring instruments into the mix in real time. And I'm excited to see Mr. Reason's overview of this exciting software tool.
Thank you very much. Yes, and welcome to my presentation or my talk about the Tidal Looper, or you could say an introduction into live sampling with Tidal Cycles. I am the developer of this tool too. So I try to enable everybody so that you can use the Tidal Looper, and hopefully I can motivate you to try out the Tidal Looper, because I think there are so much potentials for experiments with these combination of input signals and tidal cycles that it would be quite awesome to see what everybody else who is interested in this topic will do with it. And thanks for the introduction. Yes, I'm Mr. Reason, aka Thomas Grund from Leipzig, Germany. I call myself a Tidalist. But I'm an electric guitarist too and a software engineer. And to tell you about, I just want to share you some insights, the story about this whole stuff, because Tidal Cycles and the community is like, for me, like a companion during this pandemic. And I wrote my master thesis about this topic, and the Tidal Looper is the outcoming project, and I'm glad that I'm able to share it with you. And I want to take the moment to say, or just say thank you, because it is so amazing to be part of this community, and everybody is so nice and kindly and is so inspirational that this is really awesome. All right. What I want you to tell today I want to tell you some insights. As I said before, I want to show you how you can install and configure everything. Then the architecture, the setup, or you could say what you can do with it, and a setup you should need for it. And last but not least, I will give you some examples and hints I faced and learned during using this software tool. All right. As I said before, I'm an electric guitarist, and that's why I know the concept of a loop station. So my motivation was to bring this hardware the feature of a loop station into Tidal Cycles. And I researched how you could turn the functionality into code. The inspiration, as I said, are these loop stations. But in the end, I find it really interesting to see how you can use input signals and bring this into Tidal Cycles. The goal is that I created an interface which is very similar to playback a sample, so that it is not so confusing when you record a sample. You know, the goal was that the syntax and the functions are similar. So for example, when you see this loop, hashtag and the end function, then you can say, okay, this is a sample bank, and these are the number of the sample banks. nothing special. I think this is what we do as a daily routine. But here, to trigger the looper, you simply use sLooper and even the end function. But here you specify the number of a buffer you will record, not the buffer the number you will playback. And a loop station has two main modes. This one is the first one, the replace mode. And in my examples, you will see this this editor here, because I embedded it as an iframe. On the left side, you see the code. On the right side, you should see some debug informations. And okay, I have an ukulele here, and you should hear the sound. Now I will try to record it. And in this replace mode, when the pattern starts from the beginning, then the buffer will overwritten. What this means is that when I don't play any signal or I don't create any sound anymore, then the buffer will replace with silence. And you should... and fade away and replace with silence. And the other main mode, and you could say here, oh, did you hear me? Did you hear the latest example or?
Okay.
This was okay. And the overdub mode, you can say you have less code, because what I do here is that I add a layer to an existing buffer. So in the end, and as you could expect it, you can live code. And for example, re-trigger the loop. And now I just created, you could say, a new sample. Right. So hopefully this is just an introduction, a basic example, so that everybody should have in mind what I will talk about in the next slides. So what do you need to do to install and configure everything? Simply just visit the web page on my GitHub web page. github.com/thgrund/tidallooper. And when you know how you can do it, you can simply clone everything, or you can download it as a zip file when you click on code and then zip file. You need to unzip it or unpack it, and then you can install it as a quark. And this has a huge advantage, because you can simply add a single line to your startup script to initialize the Tidal Looper. Or what you can do is you can adjust default parameters during runtime, or you can configure them to your needs. So you need to click on quarks, then just install folder, select the unpacked folder, and then you should have the Tidal Looper here inside the quarks. And basically that's almost it. In the startup script, this is just a startup script, a slightly adjusted startup script from the super.web page. But in the end, this line here is important, because you simply add a single line, pass the dirt instance you declared before, and then the looper will start doing when you boot the SuperCollider server. Then you have it. But it's this is for the, yeah, you can say the first steps, but I will show you some more stuff. For my examples, I just want to tell you that I separated my audio channels and I created some virtual audio buses because for internal routing. That allows me to, you can say, to split what I want to record, even an input signal like an ukulele, a guitar or a microphone, or for example, my internal tidal cycles pattern that I playback and output. And you should have something like this, for example, when you want to split your orbits so that you don't have any overlapping audio effects, global effects. So these output signals are on my input signals too, so that I can record them. And when you see something like 4 or 5, then I, or yeah, maybe I would switch between, or not maybe, I would switch between these audio input buses, and then you could say, but I will explain it later, what I record. I could record the tidal cycles pattern or an input signal or anything else I route inside my computer. All right. And you can, as I said, configure the default values. For example, the recording level or the pre-recording level. The recording level is will be multiplied with the level or the input signal. And the pre-recorded level is, for example, when you have the overdub mode that you multiplicated or with the level of the current buffer. You see that I multiplicate with value greater than 1. This is a downside currently because I just record mono signals, but in the end I think it would be nicer to have stereo signals to avoid some side effects, but this is something for later. And yes, when you have an more advanced setup with audio routing, then you should specify your default input bus, and you can even change the default name of the buffer. The default here is loop, as you saw in the previous examples, but you can adjust it to your needs. And yes, the synth depth for recording does not have any kind of zero crossing analysis or an envelope, but this should be something for avoiding clicked noises. So this is something ongoing, but for experimentation, you can simply change the synth depth to your own, and maybe I will add this as a default synth depth in the future. Yeah, but you can switch the synth depth in real time too, just because, yeah, you can do it. Why not? This is not only a configuration, but you can freeze the loops on the SuperCollider side of a specific buffer, or you can persist them. This is, for example, useful when you create your own samples with this tidal looper. Then you can store it and use it for later. And this is what you might want to have on the tidal cycle side. When you want to change the input buses or the buffer name as with a pattern. All right, this is everything I can tell you about the installation and setup or the configuration. For the technical set. Okay. I have different possibilities. You have different possibilities. What you can record, but in the end, it is totally similar to playback a sample. So what you have is the Atom editor and your code. This code will be sent to tidal cycles, which creates OC messages, and those OC messages will be interpreted from SuperCollider. And in this SuperCollider lies the tidal looper. So this is very similar to playback. So I faced three possible input signals, which I found interesting for recording. The first one is something you might expect, recording an input signal, like a microphone or a guitar. I recommend to have an audio interface for this. Maybe you can do it just with an headset, just for experimentation, but such a audio interface has a huge advantage that you that you have better latency, and that you when you record a signal that it is in line with the code or with something you created with tidal cycles. What I do is audio routing with Black Hole or Jack. Black Hole is the new shining star in macOS, and I think it is the replacement of Soundflower. But on every other operating system, you can use a Jack audio server. Here, just a side note, but something you should know at this place. When you want to use the Jack audio routing on Windows, you have a problem when you are using SuperCollider on the 64-bit version. When you use SuperCollider on the 32-bit version, everything is fine. This is a well-known bug, but it's not impossible to use Jack audio server on Windows, just as a side note. Yeah, normally what you could do is just record this input signal, which is routed, and maybe depends on your setup, you don't even need this routing, but I just want to show you what you can do. And to split everything, you can record the audio in SuperCollider. Something what I find really interesting too is that you could route your input signals into a DAW. A DAW is a software for mixing and mastering, but you can use, for example, VST plugins there too. What I do sometimes is I route my guitar input signals into the DAW, use an amp simulation and record this amp simulation into SuperCollider. Ableton is just one example when you prefer the open source variant of a DAW, then you could try out Ardu for this. Something you might expect what you could do is record a VST synthesizer. For example, I press a button on a MIDI controller and trigger a software synthesizer in Ableton. And then I can route the synthesizer signal thanks to this audio routing, and then record everything. And the last possibility I find very interesting here is something I didn't expect during the development, is that I can even record a tidal cycles as a result of a tidal cycles pattern. Then create the audio result in SuperDirt, and this output signal can be routed to an input signal, and this input signal can be recorded. And maybe you can imagine that you can create interesting sounds when you create a pattern, loop the result, and then you loop the result you looped and sample. So, and you can create a loop of looping or a loop of sampling and create really interesting audio effects. And control the playback is like control the recording. And this is, business as usual. Trigger the code, creating the OC messages, and then with SuperDirt you create the sounds. Something you might not know is triggering the code with different devices. The normal case is you have a keyboard and send keyboard shortcuts to, for example, Atom or VS Code. You have the possibility to trigger a single line, a multi-line, or a whole editor. In Atom, it's possible that you can trigger the code with OC messages. So sometimes what I did, or what I, not sometimes, I do almost, is sending MIDI messages to SuperCollider, map the MIDI to OC, and sends this OC messages to trigger the code, like you would do with a keyboard. I use this for triggering my code with an MIDI controller you can use with the hands. And I use it to trigger the code with an OC with a MIDI controller I control with my feet. So for example, when I have my hands on a guitar, that I trigger my code with the feet because I don't have my hands ready to do this. But when you do this, you could for sure just use an software which only sends OC messages like OC, and in this way you don't even need to use your keyboard. And because this is something which causes often troubles, I guess, this is the, you can say, some kind of a boilerplate code for sending OC messages to Atom. The default port for this functionality is 3333. And this is just simply the MIDI function which listens on CC messages. And here you can see when I send a 60, then I trigger a single line, the 61 the multi-line, and the 62 the whole editor. And you can see here the example message blocks too. So what this does is simply what you would do with your keyboard. Yeah, as I said, when you just want to record your samples, you can simply use what you have. So Tidal Cycle, SuperCollider with SuperDirt, and Atom and your keyboard. When you want to have something else, for example, having fun with input signals, then you might want to have this audio interface and an input source like a microphone or guitar. And when you have more fun with it, you want to have a MIDI controller and or a DAW. Or what you could do even is trigger the synthdevs with your MIDI controller and SuperCollider. You don't even need a DAW. So the possibilities are so huge, and it depends on what you want to do and what you want to experiment with. But in the end, I think you can start wherever you want or end with whatever you have already. This is just a poster image, you could say. Everything I told you before is something you can see here. The only thing, or the only stuff I don't told you, is that this Tidal Looper sends OC messages, and you can use them, for example, to change or to change parameters in, for example, Hydra. I use this sometimes to show when a recording is starting and ending. For example, switching the color in an Hydra visual. Yes. And this is nearly that what I see in front of me. But you can say I don't have so much hardware devices in front of me because there's so much which happens inside my computer. Okay, this was a lot of information. Now we come to the more interactive parts, my examples and hints. Here I have two synths. I control with my MIDI controller. And what I want to show you here is that I can switch between these input ports, input buses, thanks to this pattern. Ah. And I had some noises there too from the previous example, but I think I hopefully you get the idea. Yeah, and something here, what I find really awesome is that you can control the length of the buffer with the length of a pattern. So for example, when you use this replace mode, then the buffer here you record on the position zero is as long as the cycle is long, or not the cycle, the pattern. It depends on the CPS, and it depends on your current pattern. There's just one thing you should know about the overdub looper, because it remembers only the first occurrence of a buffer length. This is why I don't know how you could do it better, but what you want to do is you want to layer your input signal to the existing, and that's why you don't create a new buffer on this place. But maybe this is just something, yeah, just a side note here. And there's this lovely inbuilt function qTrigger, because when your recording buffer gets longer, and you want to, for example, record about more cycles, then maybe you want to ensure that this, the recording always starts on the beginning. And as you see, when I re-trigger the statement, then this N here starts from zero. For example, one and zero. Yeah, and I found it really handsome to have a customized macro specialized for the looper. Hopefully you know SecP. SecP is something you can use for sequential your patterns, for having more structures. You can specify this pattern runs from 0 to 8. And then this pattern starts from 8 and goes to the 12th pattern, cycle. And what I did here is that I qTrigger it, and say I start the pattern from 0 to this value 2 here. So for example, you could say 0, 1, and then the recording stops. What I found very handsome. And now I can show you, you could say a real life example I used for a previous performance. And here I resample a loop. So I have a pattern, a sample, which I loop, slice it, and then I can control it. And it is adjusted to the time. Okay. And here we have everything together. All right. And that's for my talk. Thank you for listening. And to summarize everything, you can say Tidal Looper is a tool which provides live sampling with tidal cycles and is available as a supercollider quark. So have fun. I created this hashtag Tidal Looper on Instagram, and I shared some experiments I made before. And you can find even this CycleStack editor I used here on my GitHub channel. And the Tidal Looper experiments, you can find them on my Instagram channel. But I have this channel, this webpage here too. where I will upload the slides, and I will upload the slides, or I share the link on the club forum too. And yeah, and some more long experiments I did, you can find them on YouTube. For the slides I made, you can find the sources for everything I used here in the slides. And as a cake topper, I just collect some performances I faced. The awesome Emma O'Donovan and Alex McLean did a voicing code experiment where they use vocal and do some live coding with it. And yeah, hopefully I could inspire you, and I would really, really appreciate to see what you will do with this, because even I don't know what you could do. Anybody who saw heavy lifting's performance from the last marathon can say it is even possible to record your environment and do some kind of 100% ambience out of it. And that's it. Thank you very much. And hopefully we have time for some Q&A.
Hey. Thanks for the presentation. I played a bit with your looper. Mm-hmm. And the main issue I had for its use was triggering the code to start and stop recording. So obviously you gave some great tips for that. But I see that, and there is this every zero trick that Mike just presented to trigger some code at the push of a button. And it looks like it's a couple made in heaven.
Yeah. So yes, I totally think there are so many space for improvements, and I really would like to see how you can do it better. And even don't need to use when you just use your keyboard and can and when you can do everything with this, maybe you can hold back something or use the screw trigger or customize macros. But I think it's possible, because it is a little bit unusual to use it this way, because you control the length and everything with patterns, and not as you know this from a loop station, where you initialize the length of a buffer with your pressing on a button.
That's great. Thanks.
Hey, I have a question. First of all, this tidal looper is so good. It feels like it's gonna solve a lot of my challenges with the way I perform.
Thanks.
I played with this a little bit in the last couple of weeks, and I think the recurring challenge I had was being able to change my input bus, or sort of getting the right, getting my interface to talk with tidal cycles or with SuperCollider. I was hoping you could demystify that for me a little bit, and sort of maybe explain what L input does and where that number comes from. And like, if I had an arbitrary interface, how would I get it to work?
Maybe what I do is basically I use. I think this is over the top here in this, but I for internal routing and maybe for some pre-effects, but I don't, most of the time I don't use this pre-effects. You can say I have this, it is very small, right? But hopefully you get it. I route everything, every virtual audio bus and physical audio bus into Ableton. And maybe I can show you it here, this, like you can see it here. When I'm talking, I can see this number here. My microphone is on input bus 16. You can see it here show server meter. Hopefully I will tell you what you need, but in the end, I said I have 22 audio buses with, okay, maybe first of all, before I ran in a dead corner, what operating system are you using?
I use Mac OS. So I
think all right.
Now that you have the meter open, this might answer my question, I think. Now that I see it, it makes sense. I was mostly lost on what the L input values meant.
Yes, so this L input is mapped to this audio buses you find in SuperCollider. So when I use L input 16, then I record the audio signal here on 16. And the 16 is my input port of my audio interface. And I have this aggregate device where I can black hole and map connect black hole and the audio box I have here. And you see that I specified everything and that I can check double check my input signal, and then I can specify it with patterns and can switch between these audio buses here.
Okay, cool, thanks. I think this answers my question. Thank you so much.
No problem, you're welcome.
All right, let's take one more question and then head to the second show and tell session.
All right, can you hear me okay?
Is that Will speaking?
Yeah, can you hear me okay?
Yo, yes.
Okay, awesome. I'm looking forward to using this. I've always kind of wanted looping title output as a feature. And I was wondering, is there any function you have currently implemented or plan to implement that will output what's currently held in the loop buffer to a file?
You mean how you can save the result of your loop?
Yeah.
Yes, this is already implemented. I had this before as that you can do it with that you could do this with entitled cycles, but I closed this kind of API because I think when you want to persist a loop, it does make more sense to use this function persist loops, and you can specify the path where you want to store everything. And when you use the title looper as a quark, then you can use the, maybe I can show it this here, wait, you can look into the documentation with, for me, command D. And some weird stuff is in my startup scripts too. Maybe I need to find my title looper here. So there is this documentation and you can find everything. Persist free loops like here, how you can use it when you can see it, hopefully.
Yeah, awesome. Thanks.
You're welcome.